So I'm here today with our 3D printer fire alarm team. I'm Colton Blossom. I'm presenting here with Ian Laborious, Trevor Grimm, Steven Brzezinski, Elaine Dogerson, and Kendra Transky. We are smoking the bandits and we're advised by Professor Blood. So today we're going to give you a little bit of a project overview, what we're here for, what we're doing. Our subsystems are going to be covered by Ian. Trevor's going to go over our budget. Steven and Eileen are going to cover some more testing, showing how we succeeded at our goals. And then at the end, we'll have Kendra give us some takeaways, some summaries, things like that. So the project overview. Basically, first of all, everyone here is kind of, everyone here is pretty used to the 3D printer concept. It's inexpensive and easily used way to create custom plastic parts. And so because of that easy to use, there's a lot of risks involved. And it's easy to use so anyone can get into it, which means they may not think about the risks that are out there before they get into the system. First of all, there's obviously high yield. And the nozzle to be able to print this plastic is at 250 degrees Celsius or about 400 degrees Fahrenheit. Of course, this creates a fire risk in and of itself. Then we have cheap electronics. To get these printers in for under $200 in some cases, electronics are not the highest quality. They come from China, Taiwan, other import countries where the regulations aren't quite so stringent, and anyone who has a 3D printer will tell you that electronics are the first thing to go. Unsupervised activity. So the 3D printer itself, these parts can take anywhere from 10 minutes to 24 hours to 2 days or more to complete. So of course it's not going to be expected that you're going to sit there and watch it the entire time to ensure nothing goes wrong. Therefore, of course, you're going to be gone. And in that case, if something goes wrong, you won't know until you get back. And finally, dangerous environments. Not that the 3D printer is in a dangerous environment per se, but it goes into previously safe environments that turns them dangerous. Because you might have this in your bedroom, or in your home, or in a classroom, or an office. Places that you're not really looking for something to be wrong. Of course, if it's in a factory or workshop, you're kind of expecting things to go wrong, you're looking for them, you're prepared for it. In your home, you might not be. And so, you're not looking for issues, and yet they still may be there. The Wohlers report is kind of the financial overview, the financial Bible of 3D printing. And in 2018, they reported that between 2016 and 2017, over half a million 3D printers were sold, and the market value was $7.3 billion. This doesn't include external investments from companies like GE or Boeing, who are using them for some of their products. The market growth has been an average of 21% over the last 3 years, so this is great growth that we're hoping to jump on and be a part of. And then finally, some of the goals of our product. We want to be able to detect the smoker fire so that we can tell there's a problem with your printer. We want to turn off the printer immediately, suppress the fire, and then alert the customer. Because it's no good if we do all this and you come home and your house is smoky and you don't know why. There's no competition in this market right now. There's no other product that's capable of doing more than two of these objects. And so we want to be able to do all four. To explain how we're going to do that, I'm going to pass it off to you.
So, to do this, our system is broken down into three main subsystems, the first of which is the detection. So what this does is we need to be able to detect either a flaming fire or a smoldering fire. The difference is whether or not you can see the flame. And to do that, we have a dual smoke sensor. What that means is that it is both a photoelectric and ionization sensor all in one housing, and this guarantees our system's ability to sense really thin smoke that you would get from something that's smoldering or pretty thick smoke that you get from flaming plastic. Pictured here is the sensor housing, and in the green is the sensor inside the housing, and that would be installed inside the 3D printer enclosure. So if anything goes wrong, it can sense it. This is a very high-level depiction of the circuit in the sensor where you, in essence, have your two smoke sensors that go to an OR gate, and if either sensor is triggered, it tells the Arduino to deploy the system. There are, in the future, we would add a test button, and that would just be as simple as expanding the OR gate. So this is the main system housing. Outlined in red is the suppression system, and that is composed of the CO2 tank, pressure regulator, and the solenoid. And what happens is when the detection, when the smoke sensor detects smoke of some kind, it triggers this relay, which activates the solenoid and deploys roughly 3 ounces of CO2 into the enclosure. What this does is it suffocates the fire as well as cooling down the area because the CO2 is coming out at near freezing temperatures. In addition, this relay is shut off, and that is what cuts power to the printer. And in the housing, we also have the three components of the alert system, which are the alarm, this microcontroller, which acts as the email alert system, and LEDs that come out of the hole at the very top of the housing. So the alert system, the goal is to send three different alerts, a visual, an audio, and an email alert. So even if you are not at home, you are able to know what has happened. To accomplish this, we have LEDs, a piezo buzzer, and the ESP32 feather board. So for these to meet our criterion, the LED strip had to be active and flash at less than 5 hertz. This is because in our research, anything 5 hertz and over has a chance to cause epileptic seizures, and we want to avoid that. The piezo buzzer is rated at 120 decibels if it's powered fully at 12 volts. We are only powering it with 5 volts, so we can stay in the sweet spot where it's loud enough where you can hear it, but it's not so loud that it will damage your ears. Between 75 and 110 decibels at a 10-foot range. And then the feather board just acts as our way to send the email, and currently it's over Wi-Fi. And to talk about the cost associated with all these subsystems, I'm handing it off to Trevor.
So I just want to give a quick rundown of the budget. So the final cost of all the components that we ended up using in our final design was $332. This was well under our SDRD requirement of $400. And it also, we at the end of the first semester, we had estimated that it was going to cost around $300. So this was close to that amount. The total amount we spent was around $450, but this includes a lot of components that we didn't end up using in our final design, such as we bought an inexpensive pressure regulator at the beginning that we ended up needing to get a much more expensive one to handle the pressure associated with our system, as well as a lot of the testing equipment that we didn't end up, or that wasn't included in our final design, like the smoke detector spray that we used, as well as a lot of the refills for our tank. For the CO2 tank that we used in the suppression tests, as well as the weight sensor test at the beginning that we didn't end up using either. And then you just see the spending by the different subsystems. So here's just a visual breakdown of how much each subsystem was, the amount that was spent on each subsystem. So as you can see, suppression and the electrical components were by far the most, and this is because in the electrical, or in the suppression subsystem, it included our two most expensive components, the pressure regulator and the solenoid valve, and then the electrical components is more expensive as well because it's used in a lot of the different subsystems. So now, just to talk about a few of the tests we did, here's Steven.
All right, so as Trevor said, I'm going to talk about the first of the 8 tests that we did to confirm our SDRD requirements. So the first test we did was our system power test, which satisfies SDRD requirement 7.1, which states that our system will be powered using a standard 120-volt wall outlet. It has to be able to power our Sentinel system, our smoke detectors, our alert system, our microcontrollers, as well as the 3D printer itself. The next two tests I'm going to talk about are fire detection tests, and these are to satisfy SDRD requirements 1.1, 1.2, and 1.3. which talk about our visual and audio reaction times, as well as our suppression reaction time. So test 2 was our first fire detection test, which was for a smoldering fire. And essentially what we did was we took a ball of paper and we set it on fire, and we put it inside this 4 cubic foot mock enclosure right here. and we set it on fire, and our system, this proved that our system can detect a fire. And if you look here, you'll see these LEDs turn from green to red when our system has detected. All right, and then the third test we did was another fire detection test, but this one was for a flaming fire. It's essentially the same test as test two, but instead of using paper, we used ABS plastic to produce a flaming fire rather than a smoldering fire. And again, in the video, you will see the LEDs change from green to red when our system detects. All right, and then the fourth test we did was our fire suppression test. So this one sort of integrates all three of our systems, our detection alert and suppression system. And this is essentially the same test as test three. We put ABS plastic inside of our 4-cubic-foot enclosure, and we did a full 45-second CO2 release. We determined this to be the number in order that we needed to satisfy SDRD requirement 2.1, which says that we have to fill our enclosure with at least 22% CO2 by volume. This 45-second release we determined would fill it with about 44% CO2 by volume, which is double the amount that we needed. And we also satisfied requirement 2.2, which says that all visible surfaces must be below 300 degrees Celsius within 5 minutes of suppression. And as you can see, the highest temperature in the enclosure was 32 degrees Celsius 5 minutes after. And then here is a video showing this fire suppression test. You can see our LEDs will turn red, and then the flaming fire will be suppressed when our system detects. So as you can see, our system was able to detect the fire, alert the user, and suppress the fire. And to talk about the final four of our eight tests, I'm going to pass it off to Ivan.
So moving on to the latter half of our testing, test five, we were evaluating the notification system. So this is the email alert, the visual and audio alarm, and LEDs as well. So these three requirements talk about the speed at speed and limitations of these systems. SDRD requirement 3.1 talks about the speed at which we want to send an email once the system detects a fire. And as you can see from table number one on the left, the average time that we got from these six trials was about 4.18 seconds. That is less than the 15 seconds that we desired. Next, the SDRD requirement 3.2 talks about the buzzer volume. Like Ian said, we don't want it to be too quiet so the user can't hear it, also not too loud that the user is hearing. So what we did was we set up six different tests at different locations radially around the unit at a distance of 10 feet, and the average volume of the buzzer was about 85 seconds, which is well within that 75 to 110 decibel range we were expecting. And finally, requirement 3.3, going over the flashing frequency of the LEDs, we ended up not having those flash, so we have met that requirement as well. So system test six is the reset portion of the device, and that is essentially how quickly the system resets itself when the user presses the reset button. And as you've seen from previous demonstrations in the past, this is pretty much instantaneous. There is no measurable delay that we can see, so this requirement has also been met less than 1 second. Test seven goes over the system size requirement. Our customer wanted us to have this unit be small, about the size of a small fire extinguisher, which we translated into 6 by 6 by 15 1/4 inches volume. So what we did was we had three team members measure these dimensions, and they averaged to about 5 3/4, a little over 5 3/4, and a little around 15 inches. So this also satisfies that requirement. And we had a requirement as well for the system mounting. And as you've seen in previous demonstrations, we are able to mount the system to a printer in a stable and impermanent way so that it's flexible for many types of printers. And finally, the ease of maintenance. So we wanted the users to be able to remove the CO2 tank, go get it refilled, and put it back in very easily. We don't want any pinching points. All the accessibility of the device was important to us. So what we did was we ran a test with 20 students, had them open the door of the device, take out the CO2 tank, and reinstall it, close the door. And the results are here. The minimum time that we got was 22 seconds, shout out to Justin. The maximum time was 92 seconds, so about a minute and a half, and this averaged to 49 seconds. This is way below the 5 minutes that we had set, so we are confident that our device is easily maintained by a variety of different users. So next, I will pass it off to Kendra to talk about the key takeaways of the project.
So one of our main frustrations with this project was getting the email alert. So at the beginning of the year, we had a couple good existing projects that we were going to work on, and then once we actually started to implement them, we realized they were outdated, and there was a newer protocol in 2018 that made it so we couldn't use those projects. So we learned that preliminary research is important, and to make sure that your articles are not out of date. And then also, we kind of lumped in our decision for our microcontroller in with how we're going to connect to the internet and what we're going to do to send an email. So we ended up choosing the Arduino because we had these existing projects where we knew we could send an email off the Arduino. And then we ended up deciding later that we wanted to use Ethernet instead, and we already bought a Wi-Fi shield. So we just kind of had a progression of decisions that should have been made before we even decided to use the Arduino. And the way that we ended up sending the email, the Arduino didn't have enough computing power, so we had to use two microcontrollers, and that's not prime. And then lastly, knowing when to bail out of a decision. So our system used to be oriented horizontally, and we had a lot of problems with icing, and we spent a lot of time doing calibrations. We got an anti-siphon tube, and we really tried to make that work instead of just flipping it vertically like we have it now. And then also with SMTP2Go, we are going to use this as an email server, and this is something we found like really early in the year, but it didn't work, and we kind of fell down the rabbit hole, and we really wanted to make it work when the right decision was to just like leave all that work behind and start something new. So future iterations, we want to be able to only have one microcontroller, and the microcontroller to do this would be the Raspberry Pi. It has the computing power to do what we would need, and it connects to the internet a lot easier. And then also, we definitely want to have it connected to the internet through Ethernet, and this is because it's a lot more reliable and it's a lot safer. People don't always have the best Wi-Fi connectivity, and we want people relying on this device, so we don't want a faulty Wi-Fi connection to end up harming them. And then also, we're going to put in phone jacks on the sensor box and to the housing. So, okay, the sensor doesn't work, but, or the, so in the sensor box, you can see between the sensor box and the system, there's a lot of wires that look really bad. So we want to put a phone jack on the sensor box and the housing so the user can just have their own cable, and that will look a lot better. And then also, we want to design our own weight sensor. So one of the things we had to forego when we flipped our system from horizontal to vertical was our weight sensor. And this was because it's cantilevered, so when we had it vertical, we had it resting on the weight sensor, but when we flipped it, we couldn't hang it off the weight sensor. And this is something we still want to do, but we just need a different weight sensor. So today we talked to you about our project and why there's a need for this and how we're going to solve that. We went through our three different subsystems of alert, detection, and suppression. And then we talked about our budget, how much we spent to make this, and how much we can spend to remake it. And then also we talked about our SERD, the different test results we came up, the different tests we came up to test it, the SERD, and the results we got from those. And then I talked about our key takeaways and what we can improve in the future. Are there any questions?
What do you have an org?
photoelectric and ionization, those two systems working at the same time, we like need to look at both of those.
Yeah, the lines are two good at that.
Because we only have one output going from the sensor. So we took this sensor from a fire alarm, so we weren't really in control of like what outputs we get.
So for this, we cut 3 feet of ABS filament.